Harper One and Harper Audio present Longpath, Becoming the Great Ancestors Our Future Needs, An Antidote for Short-Termism by Ari Wallach. This is the author. A note before we begin. For images that help explain some of the topics in the book, all of the journal prompts, space to write, and more, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to harpercollins.com/pages/longpath. I strive to become a great ancestor to the multitudes of generations to come, but above that, I hope I have been a great father to my children, Eliana, Ruby, and Gideon. This book is dedicated to you and all that you are and will become. One day, a man named Honey was walking along and saw a man planting a carob tree. Honey asked him, "How many years will it take until it will bear fruit?" He said to him, "Not for 70 years." Honey said to him, "Do you really believe you'll live another 70 years?" The man answered, "I found this world provided with carob trees, and as my ancestors planted them for me, so I too plant them for my descendants." From the Talmud, Ta'anit 23a. Prologue. At the heart of the city of Rome, Italy, stands a Colosseum. To this day, you can visit this iconic structure, marveling at the millions of cubic feet of travertine stone, stacked without mortar, that comprise its towering outer wall. You can stand where gladiators once stood and imagine the roar of more than 50,000 cheering spectators. If you look up, you can see stalls that house the members of the audience, completed in 80 AD. Most likely, the people filling those stalls shifted about in their seats, the hot sun beating down, snacking on chickpeas and drinking wine while waiting for the next spectacle. In the tunnels below, exotic animals paced, and fighters, many slaves or criminals, awaited their fates. The smell of blood, sweat, and decay most likely permeated the bowels of the Colosseum, where the line between life and death neared its thinnest point. We can go to this space and stand in the shadow of emperors and commoners, of women and men living very human lives. Fear and joy, hunger and satisfaction, stress and dreams all wove themselves into the lived experiences of these ancient Romans. Perhaps you can see some of yourself in them, or some of their legacies in you. Now imagine the year 4020 AD. Hard to fathom, but it is the same distance forward in time that the gladiator age is back in time for my writing this in 2022. What will the inhabitants and visitors to Rome see then? What will they imagine about our lives today? Will they visit a soccer stadium and imagine the roar of fans? Will they pay an entry fee to view the remnants of a gas-powered Vespa scooter? Will they marvel at simulations of traffic dysfunctions that led an average motorist to lose 254 hours a year, trapped in a metal box with wheels? Will they recreate gelato recipes using the old ways? Is pizza still a thing? What will they think about the problems we faced? Will they look at graphs showing extreme rises in temperatures or drought and resent us or be proud of us for the actions we took? Will they imagine the chaos of a global pandemic and feel confusion or empathy about our response? In a time that is sooner than we think, we will be their ancient past, their history. What will they write about us? I love considering time in this way. While the Roman Colosseum is a big picture example, you can create puzzles with time in ways that feel even closer to you. For those of you who are Gen X or older like me, imagine where you were in the year 1990. What did you think about? What did you wear? What music did you listen to? What were your most pressing problems? Doesn't seem that long ago, right? Now, if I do a little bit of math, I can tell you that today you are closer to the year 2050 than you are to 1990. In 2050, they will be listening to what you hear as today's top hits regularly on Spotify on a Golden Oldies channel. In case you didn't know already, the unimaginable future of yesterday is now here. The book you're about to hear will stretch time, your brain, and your heart so that you can become the great ancestors the future needs you to be. Together, we're going to explore how looking at time with a wider lens, coupled with our emotional and collaborative strengths, can make us great ancestors and help us in our own lives. We're going to look at 4020 AD and imagine the type of people that we want to be inhabiting the earth, what they will care about, and how we can help them manifest their best lives by laying some foundations today. What's more, we're going to learn that this time, this very moment, is one of the best chances we have to make a huge impact on the lives of those to come. Let's get started. Chapter 1, Living. What Longpath is and why we need it. Look and listen for the welfare of the whole people, and have always in view not only the present, but also the coming generations, even those whose faces are yet beneath the surface of the ground, the unborn of the future nation. From the great law of the Haudenosaunee, the founding document of the Iroquois Confederacy. You might expect I'd start a book titled Longpath with a story about how every journey of 1,000 miles starts with a first step. Or maybe you're expecting to hear about the 20-year journey to build the Transcontinental Railroad, connecting the East and West Coasts of America. Or the 200-year process of building the Great Wall of China. Or maybe even something about moonshots. Perhaps you expect a sermon on how we need to really, truly start acting on climate change, because there will soon be 1 billion climate refugees roaming the planet in search of shelter and water. I'll get to all of these in good time, but truth be told, the story of the future of human civilization often starts with something pretty innocuous. For instance, a buzz from a phone. I was in the kitchen making my world-famous dragon eggs dinner, eggs scrambled with cut-up hot dogs and cheese, when I felt a vibration in my pocket. It was an app notification from our local school. My 12-year-old daughter, Ruby, had missed turning in her Spanish assignment, which had been due exactly 12 seconds before. My instant reaction to that buzzing, though, was hundreds of thousands of years in the making. All sorts of chemicals and neurotransmitters started firing in my brain. Anger that she missed the assignment, sure, but beneath that was shame. What kind of parent am I? Fear, if she keeps this up, she won't get into her choice of college. And a deep-seated sense that by doing something wrong, I had upset members of the tribe and was going to find myself pushed out of the cave tonight, forced to fend for myself against large animals with very big teeth. With all of this going through my mind and body, I had a choice to make. Freak out, lose my shit, yell at Ruby, or pause and follow the principles of Longpath. Longpath. A simple but profound mindset that shifts thinking from the short term to the long term allowed me to take that half-second pause and recognize the swirl of chemicals and hormones rapidly welling up inside me. And in that pause are the hundreds of thousands of years that came before that moment, the hundreds of thousands of years that would come after, and the awareness that I was just a link in a greater chain of being. I was, in my best impression of Carl Sagan, part of a pale blue dot in the ever-expanding universe of space and time. Half a second later, I realized that whether Ruby knew what biblioteca meant would not dictate her future or our collective humanity's future. What was most important was not getting worked up over the missed assignment. That would get resolved later after we had dinner, and I could talk to her about it. What mattered was maintaining the balance of mental and emotional states of mind as we were about to sit down as a family. A ritual where how I connected with my loved ones would have a much greater ramification on Ruby's future than a single missed assignment. And then, even later, I'd do the most important thing, turn off those annoying phone notifications from her school. We all have moments like these, probably more often than we realize. We live in a world of constant updates, notifications, and breaking news, and these all conspire to spike our cortisol and adrenaline levels, elicit fight-or-flight responses from our central nervous systems, and, if poorly managed, send us spiraling down into a pile of smoldering emotional wreckage. This is the result of short-term, reactionary thinking, which, while valuable at times, can bubble over if it isn't kept in check, we lose sight of the larger whole, of what really matters to us in the big picture. The problem is that a short-term mindset being a set of beliefs that influences how you think, feel, and behave, gets triggered constantly, whether it's a distressing work email that intrudes late in the evening, or the self-inflicted guilt that comes from a dad who feels he's not doing enough for his daughter in Spanish class. These experiences are the new normal for so many of us, yet we face challenges that require us to go beyond this way of thinking and acting. There are moments when we need to think bigger than right now, and think about a few hours from now, a few days from now, a few years from now, a few generations from now. The long path mindset works in part to help relieve our reactions to stressful moments by providing a way of seeing the world that cultivates future conscious thinking and behavior. Longpath helps us start thinking and feeling beyond our own individual lifespans and to the impact we will have on future generations. And yes, that previous generations have had on us. But Longpath is more than a mantra, a handy mindfulness timeout reminder, or a five-step prescription for a better tomorrow. It's a way to move about the world with the right frame of mind. It helps us prioritize the things that truly matter and recognize what doesn't. Longpath is a mindset, a way of being, and an approach to life in the universe that seeks comity and union with all other living and non-living things across time and space. Taking a view from 30,000 feet in the sky and 30,000 years into the past and the future. Longpath reminds us that we are part of something bigger than ourselves, and that while our own time is finite, we need to become the great ancestors our descendants need us to be. This risks sounding heavy and abstract, but Longpath can find expression in something as simple as a jogging track. My friend Michelle was part of a construction team building a new high school sports track and soccer stadium in her town. She felt a lot of pressure to finish the project on time and on budget. When a supplier came to her and explained that there was a new corn-based track surface material they could use, Michelle was about to reject it outright. It would last five times as long and had a lower carbon footprint in its manufacturing process, but it would cost much more and take a lot longer to lay down. She thought of the heat she might take if she agreed, and the installation deadlines and budgets her team had to hit to ensure their bonus. Wait a second, she thought. What's the ultimate goal here? Make her bonus, or build a stadium that would last so that the next generations wouldn't have to start the work all over again? A delay in an earlier output of funds made much more sense than pushing something through so that she could be done with it and look good. She decided to at least try to make the better materials work. When Michelle felt her initial impulse to reject the new material, and when I felt my initial impulse to hassle Ruby about her Spanish, we were doing what humans do. Warding off a seemingly immediate threat, trying to fit in with the tribe, aiming to protect our short-term interests. But when we paused and considered the bigger, and yes, longer picture, and our place within it, we were practicing Longpath. In time and with practice, that pause for Michelle, for me, ideally for all of us, gets shorter and shorter until Longpath becomes the automatic way we think, react, and eventually shape the future. A rabbi goes into West Point. My dad was born in Poland and orphaned after the Germans killed his parents during World War II. He became a forest-dwelling resistance fighter when he was just a teenager and often said in his heavily accented English, "If you forget the past, you don't have a future. What happens tomorrow started yesterday." I grew up grounded in this conception of time, and my kids know that they are alive today because of the decisions my dad made during World War II to resist and to fight. He said that to get revenge on Hitler, he didn't want to just kill Nazis. He wanted to have children, and in turn, grandchildren. My dad's story looms large in my life, but it's only one piece of my heritage. My mother was an artist, an exceptional one, who studied under the futurist, systems thinker, and acclaimed design engineer Buckminster Fuller. A typical weekend day of my youth would see me at a San Francisco art museum with my mom, talking about the interplay of colors and texture and nuance while viewing a sculpture by Alexander Calder. And then we'd go home to my father's world, where you watched old World War II movies and were more likely to discuss the precepts of power from Sun Tzu's The Art of War than the shades of purple in a sunset. I lived in a home that existed in separate times, a dad who, while extremely social and intelligent, could never fully escape the trauma of the 1930s and 40s, living in the what was, and a mom who was modern and lived in the what could be. A typical dinner conversation would therefore usually span back and forth between the 1920s and the 2120s. And there I sat, in the in-between. As a result of my yin and yang upbringing, my life...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.